Okay.
Okay.
I believe right now you're in between touring or in between making records. Am I correct?
Yeah. We just finished a tour of Europe, which was like a 2-month tour, which was quite intensive. We did just about every country in Europe, finishing off in England. And I've just been working on finishing off the film. One of the shows in France, in fact, was televised, you know, by BBC television, and just helping them finish that off. That will be coming out this year. And apart from that, not much happening until the tour of Japan. It's getting quite close now.
You were working on this BBC film yourself?
Just kind of helping them a little bit with choosing the right song and this kind of stuff, you know? And supervising the mixing of the soundtrack, that was really the main thing. Make sure it didn't sound terrible.
How did the last tour go, by the way?
Very, very well. It was kind of, well, I think it was the most successful tour we've ever had. First time you ever made a real profit.
Is that right?
Yeah, well, I think that's probably because half of the dates were outdoors, you see. They were playing to quite big crowds, I mean, up to 30,000 or something. You know, sort of football stadiums, things like that. Which makes a change from, you know, the smaller kind of theatre and so.
Do you find that sort of setting very difficult to perform in, though?
I do, yes. I mean, it's much too impersonal for me, but the main difficulty is the sound. It's a kind of... The thing I get used to is the sound bouncing back at you from the walls of whatever building you happen to be in, but when you play out of doors, the sound just kind of disappears into nowhere, literally into thin air. And I find that kind of dissatisfying. So my ideal kind of place would be like there was a place we played in Rotterdam on this tour, which was perfect, like 10,000 seater, but indoors, like a cycle stadium or something, sports stadium. And that's my favorite kind of auditorium and size.
I see. I'd like to ask you a bit about the most recent album, Avalon. It did quite well in Japan. Well, it's actually doing quite well in Japan, and the tickets for the upcoming tour are selling quite well also. How do you interpret or analyze this success? It's sold already twice as many albums as Flesh and Blood.
Any of the previous 10 albums or whatever. I don't know, hopefully you like to think as an artist that you improve a bit with every year. As long as you don't run out of ideas, you certainly learn, you know, with every record that you make, a little bit more about the craft of making a record, you know, of making music. And I think the real answer to your question, though, is that it's kind of more instrumental. There are, in fact, two instrumental tracks on the album for a start, and there are quite a few longish instrumental passages. And I think the less singing, the better, as far as foreign countries are concerned. You know. You see what I mean?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Well,
you know, because I think people can relate much more to the mood of a piece of music than to the mood of a lyric if they're Japanese or French or German. And the same thing has happened in France on this album. On Germany, it happened with the album before, where we kind of quadrupled the sales, say. And that's a very nice feeling. I mean, it would be terrible if I thought the music was inferior to previous records, but I don't. I think it's better in many ways. The playing is very good on the record, you know, from the various musicians. I think that is really why it appealed to a broader spectrum of the public in foreign countries. One other thing about this tour, by the way, is that it was the best, musically it was the best band that I've ever had, the best Roxy band that's ever been on stage before. Half of the people were American, and basically all the people who played on the album were on stage, and it was very much a musical experience, as opposed to a theatrical one. Although it looked pretty good as well, and like the singers were great. I always like to work with, you know, backing singers, and it's always a treat for me to have them there. And they offer a lot of kind of visual support as well as musical.
Who was playing with you on that tour?
Well, Phil Manzanera, obviously, and Andy Mackay from the regular Roxy team, and Neil Hubbard is the other guitar player who has in fact played on the last four albums I've made. So he's kind of a regular fixture as well, and very important to the overall sound. Aaron Spenner is the bass player, who's also in this. He's played on the last three or four albums too. Andy Newmark is American. He's the drummer, who is kind of brilliant, I think. Also from New York is a percussionist called Jimmy Mayer. The keyboard player is English. He's from called Guy Fletcher. And the three singers were Fonzie Thornton and Michelle Cobb and, wait for it, Tawatha A.G. And they're three black singers from New York. And they've sung with all sorts of people, you know, great, there's some special people in New York. And they played with Chic and Aretha Franklin and other greats. So the standard of musicianship is very high, I think.
In recent years, you seem to have made a sort of...
I sort of danced around and orchestrated.
In recent years, you seem to have made a sort of a switch to using more and more studio musicians. Why?
I think it's because my musical kind of interests, or what I've been trying to do, has demanded a kind of very high level of skill, which generally I've found, easier to get from studio musicians. And people always complain in theory about that. Say, oh, well, you know, studio musicians never play with any feeling and so on. I just kind of refute that, and I don't think that's the case. I think it depends what kind of... Sure, they kind of spend some of their time making jingles and this, that, and the other, you know, and doing kind of fairly, you know, sort of bread-and-butter work. But I find that whenever I've worked with them, they've always given their best and played with kind of passion, which is one thing I always kind of demand from any musician I work with. You know, that he plays with feeling. I think if the technique is there, it's always kind of that bit easier to get what you want from a player, I think. You always assume that they're going to be able to play their instrument very well, and what you hope is that they'll sort of grasp the mood of the piece, you know, and just kind of lock into the feeling that you're trying to put over yourself.
To get back into the album a bit more, it seems that from Flesh and Blood, well, actually in both Flesh and Blood and Avalon, you seem to, well, I'm actually interpreting here a question from a Japanese journalist, but you seem to have dropped some of the European sort of nihilism that formerly characterized your music.
Pardon
me?
Sorry, I didn't quite catch
the European nihilism.
Uh-huh.
that he feels characterized your music in the past. And apparently he feels that this element has decreased somewhat in your music, and it's gone in more of a, say, positive, up sort of direction.
Yeah. Well, it's funny, when you're kind of writing music over a period of, well, 10 years, you kind of occasionally look back at your own work and examine it and try and do something a little bit different. So I find I'm always trying a little bit to push myself into different areas, you know. It's a terrible feeling to feel that you're very easily categorized. And you kind of get fed up with writing very bleak songs. So occasionally you try to push yourself into... I find that kind of melancholic kind of mood the easiest sort of song to write. But occasionally I try to push myself, you know, in a sort of, more, I'd say, more of an up direction.
Well, do you find you're sort of out of this melancholic mold then?
Oh, I think it's always there, lurking. You just try to, cover different ground.
What do you think inspired you to take this sort of new direction, assuming that this sort of melancholy feeling pervaded your music in the past?
I still think I'm a fairly gloomy sort of... I'm a fairly gloomy after it, I don't know, it's sort of balanced with a kind of vague optimism as well. And there have been some changes in my life, I suppose, in the last year or so, you know, since I got married, and I've now got a child. So I guess that should make me feel a little bit different, but I mean, I don't really feel any different at all. I suppose I probably feel more relaxed with my work. And this is possibly a little bit less frantic about it. It's still very, very important to me. It's still what I do, you know, and what I do best is make records, I think. I still love doing it and haven't lost any of the enthusiasm for it. But, and also, I suppose I've spent in the last year or so more time thinking, you know, more seriously about the work, and, you know, going out to less nightclubs, etc.
So you think definitely this new lifestyle...
It must have had some effect on the work, and I can't really pinpoint it myself, but I think it probably has.
Well, have you, like, written any new material since Avalon?
Not really, I haven't had any time. Ever since the record was kind of finished, it's all kind of, everything's kind of segued into everything else. I sort of finished the record, then had to go back to mix it, and then cut the record, and then do the cover for it, and then start rehearsing for the tour. Then I did the tour, and now that's finished, and I haven't really had time to draw breath. I've been in the studio, I suppose, about 3 days in the last few months, trying to get in to do something new, but I haven't had much time at all. I've sort of started off a couple of things, which probably won't be finished for another few months yet. But I'm looking forward to it. I always like to get on with the new thing. I think it's the healthiest approach to do that. But until the Japanese tour is finished, I can't really wash my hands of Avalon itself and start with the new thing.
What do you think you'll be doing before, up until the Japanese tour?
Oh, well, hopefully I'll get sort of a 10-day holiday or something. And, I might either go to the Caribbean for a week, or try to stop somewhere en route to Japan, like Bangkok or somewhere. just a bit of a change.
The album...
Probably spend Christmas at home in the country and New Year in Scotland. I'm going up to Scotland to stay with some people. So hopefully see a bit of snow, etc.
Well, you're traveling around quite a bit. Is this with family or on your own?
I will be over the Christmas period, yeah.
Avalon was enormously popular all around the world, except for America.
Yeah.
That's sort of an interesting point there. You were talking about the instrumental quality of it, perhaps accounting for the success in countries like Japan and France and whatnot. But why the poor response?
Well, not America. I really don't know. I mean, it's very weird, especially curious is the fact that it was so amazingly successful in Canada, where it's kind of, I think it's what they call it, double platinum, you know? You know, which is really weird. It's the same record company. So I can only assume, and obviously they do follow English taste more in Canada than, you know, the radio, etc., than they do in the States, but it's hard to really think that it's that different. I guess it must be. I mean, it just hasn't been played, I suppose. But you know what American radio is like?
Yeah, I'm afraid so.
It seems to be becoming more and more conservative again as far as being, you know, severely programmed. I don't know, it's a mystery really. And I can see reasons and I can always kind of give reasons for it, but it still surprises me nevertheless. I know there wasn't a single as such on that album, and America tends to demand that you have at least one hit single from an album in order to sell the rest of the work, you know?
I sort of
said to the record company, I didn't think there was a real sort of American single there at all, but I felt it was a very kind of integrated album where each track was, to me at any rate, as important as the next track, which is a kind of, to me, a rarity in this day and age where most albums seem to be one or two really good songs with the rest being padding, you know? That seems to be the general case.
What about a little bit more on, say, some of your colleagues in the current music industry? Has anything stood out recently, in your opinion? Good or bad?
No one person, but I think the standard is quite high from the industry, and that's all I'm really aware of, I think. I can't think of anything new that's come out of America, really. But there are a lot of very attractive sounding and looking, I suppose, English groups in the last 2 years. I mean, things like the Human League, and they were actually very successful in America too. But there's a sort of like a pop band, I suppose. Human League and Duran Duran. They're all doing work of a fairly good standard to me. But nothing, it's not that amazing to you, I suppose.
You seem almost underwhelmed by their work.
I've never heard that before. Well, I am. I mean, but that's not to put them down. I just don't really have a very high opinion of most modern music, really. I don't really listen to much at home. I never kind of listen to records very much. And the last record I sat and listened to was Aretha's new album. And that's just, you know, because she's a personal favorite, really. And also she was produced by a friend of mine, Luther Vandross, who's very hot at the moment in America. And also the singers from the group were singing on that album, too. So. I sort of checked that one out. But generally, I don't really listen in detail too much, unless it's on the, you know, I'm driving the car, listening to the radio, and keeping in touch in that way with what other people are doing. But there are, on any given week in England, I think there's a lot of kind of new, you know, pretty good stuff, good records out. But usually they're kind of, you know, singles and not backed up by strong albums as such.
Well, speaking of other artists, on the last, not actually on the album, I believe it was a separate single, but you did a cover of John Lennon's Jealous Guy.
Right.
The journalist I'm working with right here was wondering what John Lennon meant to you, and
well, he was my, most of my influences or heroes in music have always been American ones, and more often than not, Black American artists. You know, whether they were sort of jazz players, you know, like Coltrane or Charlie Parker or whatever, Billie Holiday. Or, you know, several people like Otis Redding and Tampa Motown people and so on. But John Lennon was my kind of favorite English artist. And I just always liked his voice. I liked just about everything he did, especially the things that he wrote with the Beatles. When I'd always wanted to do one of his songs, which I thought I'd probably do someday on a solo album or something. But when he died, we had to play a special kind of televised concert in Germany, which is quite a big event for us. I mean, it was sort of being televised through Europe. And it was about a week after he died, I think. And I wanted to do a song that we hadn't done before for the show, because we've been touring there with the Flesh and Blood album not long before that. So I felt we had to do a new song for them. And I think we rehearsed Jealous Guy, which I thought was a great song. And I just loved the song very much, you know. I thought it was, to me, one of the strongest things he'd ever written. And certain songs that people write just touch you in a certain way. That's all there is to it, and you feel the same kind of feelings or something, and you feel like you're going to maybe interpret the song as well. So we did that song, and everybody sort of concerned with us, like the record company people and management, and so on, said, you know, you must record it. I'd never really thought of recording it. I just rehearsed for the show. But then we did the recording of it, and it proved to be the biggest record we'd ever had in England.
Are you very...
It's never appeared on an album.
Apparently, yes.
I don't know, that's the song I happened to like a lot. The year before he died, I'd been playing the Imagine album a lot in the car. And that's the song I always tend to play twice. Jealous Guy was my favorite from that album. Not no real kind of motive apart from that. I suppose I am quite a jealous sort of person anyway. I just felt it was quintessential Lennon, if you see what I mean. It was kind of just very raw and very soulful song.
This may strike you as a somewhat odd question, but I have here on my list one that asks your opinions of a man's position in a traditional, say, love relationship. In other words, a man is expected to be very tough in the pillar of a relationship, whereas in your music, this idea, this concept, has sort of been treated somewhat negatively or even ignored, perhaps. Would you agree with this?
That's a hard question for long-distance Tokyo.
My apologies.
it's I've never thought about it. And maybe I just haven't got around to it yet. As you suggested, I haven't got around to dealing with that yet. About man being a kind of...
Being sort of...
The central figure of the relationship.
Well, he's supposed to be tough and supposed to be, say, the pillar, the stronger half of a relationship.
It never occurred to me before that the song certainly drove to take the anti that. But maybe it'll come out that way. I don't know, perhaps I'll get around to that when I see you in person.
Okay, well, I'd appreciate that very much. How about, like, in general, like, I think love is a topic you've dealt with, love and relationships.
Most of the songs are kind of, I have tried occasionally to kind of break away from sort of love lyrics, but I don't know, it seems to be, a lot of the music, or most of the music seems to be so, it's so kind of emotional that it kind of seems to demand that it becomes very personalized in that way, and sort of exposed. Those sort of love-type words seem to kind of suit the mood of most of the songs that I write. And to sing about, traffic pollution or something, with some of those melodies, that doesn't work.
That's a good point. Well, like, a lot of artists start out with love songs, and they sort of perfect that art, and then they move on to, say, like, political...
And then the one after that is good. Religion in older age.
Why is it
it's getting towards that
perspective? Well, why haven't you, say, moved on to, say, the world of politics?
It's because it's something that I feel I have no... I've just never felt moved to do it. In an honest way, and I think that lyrics always have to be very honest and from the heart, as well as from the mind. And there are certain kind of things that I have, political kind of areas that I have thoughts about, but I don't really feel that I'm... that I know enough about most political issues. Not being much of a political animal myself, I never have been. I've always had my head in the clouds and been very much the kind of artist who is more concerned with kind of human type problems than, universal, of a political nature. And I think it's fine when other people do write about that sort of stuff and pull it off, but it doesn't usually interest me very much or move me. I think it's possibly because I'm English, and the English are the least political of all people, it seems. And I never discuss politics with friends, or very much at all, or since they're mostly kind of artist-type people. I just don't feel it's my area, and I don't like to write about things I don't know enough about.
Well, I think that's a more than a suitable answer. I'd like to, move on to the next subject here, which deals with cinema. The gentleman sitting next to me here apparently interviewed you several years back. The gentleman sitting here next to me, the Japanese gentleman, interviewed you several years ago, at which time you said that Five Easy Pieces was a film you enjoyed quite a bit. And he was wondering what other films you have enjoyed since then.
I saw one which hasn't in fact appeared in England yet. I don't know if it ever will. I saw it in New York earlier this year, called Once in the Heart, which is Coppola's film, Francis Ford Coppola. And it was a film that flopped miserably in the face.
It did.
It was very, very artistic, but I'm afraid a box office flop. It's very, very, very beautiful, very theatrical. It looks like a kind of Broadway play. It's like I'm trying to do an Italian kind of film, like Visconti or something, or Fellini. It is kind of quite remarkable. That's the best picture I've seen, I think, since I spoke to the gentleman.
Are you a fan of Coppola's in general?
Not particularly. No, I just happen to like this picture. I'll tell you what I saw as well, which is quite good. It's the Blade Runner, which is Ridley Scott. Which is very good. There are not really that many films of it that I see, and I think they're that great at the moment.
You know, it's funny, it may sound somewhat bewildered, but the films you mentioned there are films sort of based on the mood produced in them, which is apparently what you went for in Avalon.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's right, they're both very much mood. Avalon is very much a mood album. Atmospheric,
let's see. Hmm. Once again, this same gentleman here has another interesting idea in that whereas David Bowie and people like David Bowie and John Lydon, formerly Johnny Rotten, are currently making movies, you seem like a type that would be more cut out to be a director. Would you agree?
It's something I would like to do one day, but I've never made any great efforts in that direction as yet, apart from being involved on the direction of some of the sort of film clips that we've done to go with songs, you know, but none of them have been that wonderful. I just find that music is so all-consuming in the time apart that until I feel I want to have a break from music, you know, I just keep on doing it. Sorry about the English police siren going. it's really a matter of time. I think there's always going to be time in the future to think about experimenting in other, you know, areas like that, which aren't so far away, removed from music. The main problem is learning the craftsmanship. I think the only way to start something is to start it and learn from your mistakes, I guess.
So is the cinema basically...
That might happen one day, I don't know yet.
Mm-hmm.
I still feel too involved in music to dissipate my energy, so to speak, on other things.
So you think, is the cinema your second love to music then?
Oh yes. Yeah.
With your indulgence, I've been added a couple of other questions here. Let me see, they're handed to me in Japanese, so I have to read this here. The first one involves...
That's very clever of you.
Pardon me?
I said it's very clever of you. I
don't possibly understand
it.
Well, it's not easy, let me tell you. The first one, apparently you once commented that the rock business was not a very intellectual environment to be in. You haven't?
No, I might well have said that. I'm just agreeing with it.
Have you ever felt any sort of, say, despair working within that sort of environment?
Yes, I think around sort of 76, 77 type period, I felt very close to giving up and just sort of moving out of it. I think it's supposed to maybe I've been working too hard, needed a break from it or something. So yes, there was one time when I just felt I wanted to escape from it completely, but I soon got back into it. There's only a feeling that lasted for a few months.
What brought you back? What kept you going?
Oh, I don't know, just the obsessive nature of my so-called talent. I mean, I just felt that I wanted to make another record, and then as soon as you kind of make another record and you feel that you want to go out and play it to people, and then, you find yourself doing it again. I think at the time I was living in Los Angeles for a few months, and I think it just all got to be there. It had something to do with Los Angeles tends to be a very depressive place sometimes for people, for certain kinds of people. I just didn't have any of my kind of friends there or anything. It's just a low point. I think it's very good to kind of have low points in your life, because it makes you a bit kind of stronger for the time after it. I think it can be good for one to have lows of that.
Another odd question here. Albums like Another Place, Another Time, or Avalon sort of convey the concept of getting away or finding another place. Is this type of theme something that's always been on your mind, or is it something you've gained since being after becoming a musician?
I didn't quite hear the end of the question, but I suppose I can understand where you're getting at. Actually, why don't you just repeat the second half of the question?
The second half of the question is this something that's always been on your mind, or is it something you sort of, an idea you've conceived since becoming a musician?
Oh, no, I think that I've always been a bit of a dreamer, you see. Years before I became a musician, I think I was right now when I was quite young. When I was 10 or 11 is when I started really becoming interested in music. And I used to like kinds of music that none of my sort of friends or contemporaries at school today. They weren't into that kind of music at all. My own little world, I think I've always done that. I can be sort of sitting, I'm one of those people that can be sitting in a room with a few other people or at dinner or something, and suddenly I'm just sort of drifted away, eyes glazed over, and a sort of, I'm just a dreamer and a creative person. I think it probably just comes from that, old thing.
Are there any taboos in your music, other than politics, of course? Music critic over here who is he sort of admires you as a rather a follower of fashion, a sort of a dandy. Then again, there are other people who think that he's very much mistaken and that you shouldn't be labeled as such. Do you feel there are any parts of your music or part of the whole Roxy slash Bryan Ferry image that are misunderstood? Such as?
Well, the main thing was just that, the equating kind of serious music with kind of playing around with the visual kind of imagery of the thing. But before I started to record, one of the reasons why we used to have this, dressed up with a kind of very kind of natural thing, I think, with new bands, you know, that they want to be taken notice of, that they work hard at building up their sound or whatever, and want people to listen to them, take notice of them. You'll find that most new bands do kind of take a bit more trouble with their appearance or stage act or whatever, you know, just because they feel we're new, you know, look at us. And that's a very normal thing to do. In our case, allied with that was the fact that we were all very shy and reserved, and it made it much easier for me to kind of dress up as a different kind of person to go on stage. You know? It was obviously still me, but it was a different part of me. I think that I was kind of pushing up. I'm generally considered to be very, very shy and reserved and so on. At the same time, you know, I do go on stage and sometimes that's a difficult thing to pull together, to equate the two. Over the years also, I think that, you know, how kind of, as I said before, how time-consuming the whole thing can be. As soon as you made a record, you kind of then feel like you have to talk about it to help to put it over to the people, and that includes these photographs, etc. And for me, that was always a very boring kind of part of it, doing photograph sessions and all the rest of it. So to make it more interesting, you're always going to, dress up in some way, and that has become, I think, less important, but the whole thing, the image takes on a life of its own, if you see what I mean. Sometimes it's a bit kind of distorted and a bit exaggerated, just because whenever people write about something, they can push it a bit too much in one direction or another. Sometimes I read things about myself that I don't really feel it's me at all. Might be something that I've said or something or other. And sometimes that gets in the way of the music. On the other hand, sometimes it does help the music, because people might see, it could be a picture in a fashion type magazine or something, and they maybe never heard of the music before. If they see that picture, they might be interested enough to go and listen to the music. So in that sort of case, it can work for you, or work for the music, which is the important thing. It's a very complex working on at the time, and not really wanting to think about anything else, like fixing the door or the window closed properly, or something that way, or the house is falling down. So not the best husband in the world, I would have thought, but that's how the cookie crumbles.
What about it?
I don't know, it's very difficult. You have to ask my good wife. She probably wouldn't tell you. She never has anything to do with press or interviews or anything, which is quite refreshing in fact. She has no interest in that side of things. I've found her very useful as a sounding board for, musical queries or whatever. if I sort of had a rough mix of something and played it to her. I find her opinion very valuable.
Mm-hmm.
That kind of thing.
I see.
Very good taste.
Oh. Well, does she have a musical background herself?
No, not at all, but she's listened to a lot of Brits. Well, she's a sort of, not a fan of mine, I hate to be asked. Maybe she'd like the Grateful Dead very much.
Is that right?
Yeah.
My God.
Tell me how she wants to go and be a deadhead. And she somehow met me and she got sort of way married.
That's great.
Like Neil Young and the band and that kind of stuff too, which I do like too. In fact, we've been doing a Neil Young song in the show.
Speaking of which, we're down to the last question here, which involves which numbers you plan to perform here in Japan.
Well, obviously, I suppose half of Avalon. I think it's never a good thing to play all of the new album. People like to hear a bit of the new one and then bits and pieces from the past. So it's a mixture. Usually, we'll do certain favorites, like Do the Strand and Rubber's the Plug and Dance Away. My Only Love is my favorite on stage number, I think.
What's that?
I do one from my solo thing called Can't Let Go. And we do a Neil Young song called Like a Hurricane. And one or two others.
Well, it's something that we're looking very forward to over here, and I also look forward to hopefully seeing you when you go over here, and I would like to thank you very much for your time today.
Well, thank you very much, and we're looking forward to the tour. I hope to see you there.
All right. Well,
please.
Yeah, you too, and please take care.
Yes.
Okay, then.
Well, thanks a lot.
All right.
Say hello to all our Japanese fans for me.
I certainly will.
Thank you very much.
All right, then. Goodbye.
Bye.